The Crystal Cave by Arup Kumar Datta.
Taste this, Grandma Kamlong said.
She scooped out a ladleful of broth from the pan over the fireplace.
It smelt delicious.
Grandma blew on the bamboo ladle to cool the broth. Then she poured a little into Thenyak and Changun's open mouths.
Yuck!
Exclaimed Thenyak.
It is awful.
Don't like it, do you? Said Grandma with a toothless grin. But watch now.
Using the ladle, she scooped up a little salt from a wooden bowl and put it into the broth. She sang a knocked ballad as she stirred. Then she made the children taste the broth once more.
Delicious, Grandma,
they said, smacking their lips in approval.
Magic, isn't it?
Grandma said.
The broth was tasteless before, but now it is delicious. What caused this miracle?
Salt,
the children said in chorus. Grandma placed 3 reed mats upon the floor, as well as dishes of wood and bamboo tumblers. Ladling out steaming rice and broth on the plates, she said,
That's right. For the knocked, salt is more precious than gold. Our village was rich in the past,
continued Grandma.
We grew millet and paddy in our fields. The jungles gave us shrubs, ferns, and fruits. Our young men went hunting for meat. And, most important, we had salt.
Did we make our own salt, Grandma?
Changun asked, surprised.
Yes, we did. A salt spring used to flow by our village. We built shallow troughs and filled them with salt water. The sun dried away the water, leaving grains of salt in the troughs.
Must have been a lot of salt,
Thenyak observed.
Yes, much more than what our village required. Our men stuffed the surplus into hollow bamboo tubes and took it to the plains each winter. They bartered the salt for clothes, beads, and other necessities.
But there's no salt spring now,
Changun said. Grandma sighed.
Our village is poor now. We are no longer self-sufficient. Our men walk to Khonsa Township to buy salt.
Did the salt spring dry up?
Thenyak asked.
Yes, it happened one winter, years ago. Our source of wealth dried up with it.
Why did it dry up?
Persisted Thenyak.
No one knows.
Tell me, Grandma,
he said.
If the spring flows again, will it bring prosperity to our village?
Certainly, smiled Grandma Kamlong.
Later in the afternoon, Thenyak and Changun went to search the spot where the salt spring had flowed into the river. To their surprise, they had no difficulty. The furrow through which the salt spring had flowed was clearly visible. Only ferns and creepers covered the furrow. They could see it wind up the mountain, a ribbon of light green against the darker green of dense jungles. Thenyak cried,
We can follow it upstream.
Early next day, after their morning meal, Thenyak and Changun started for their quest. Both had bamboo tubes strapped to their backs to carry drinking water in them. They were children of the mountains. The steep climb may have exhausted others, but not them. They were not afraid of the jungles either. Because they lived close to nature, they knew that most of these dangers were imaginary. Only if one accidentally disturbed a wild animal would it attack. So far they had met with only one obstacle, a large python. But it just raised its blunt, hammer-like head, flicked out its forked tongue, and slid away to a higher branch. But halfway up the mountain, a more serious obstacle came their way.
A herd of wild elephants!
Changun said.
taking care not to make the least noise, they crawled up a little ahead. They could not see the herd. The grey-black hides of the elephants blended too well with the foliage, but the sounds made by the herd, as it fed, grew louder. Soon it became clear that the elephants had chosen the spot as a feeding ground. And it seemed as if they might stay on for quite a while. There was no question of trying to slip through that herd. Their path upstream was firmly blocked.
What do we do now, Tenyak?
Changun asked.
We wait,
her brother replied grimly. The children waited. Apart from the sounds made by the feeding elephants, the jungle was silent. The deep hush was broken only twice by the hukku, hukku call of a hoolock gibbon and a pangolin scampering through the undergrowth. They waited patiently for over 2 hours, and then finally they heard heavy bodies crash through the thick foliage. The elephant herd was on the move. They climbed for an hour and all of a sudden stumbled into a clearing. Hundreds of hoof marks were visible on the ground. There were also some pug marks of wild cats and imprints of elephant feet. Changun cried out,
"It is a natural salt lick!"
Wild animals came to lick the earth for salt. This took care of the salt requirement of their bodies. The salt spring furrow ran through the center of the clearing for some distance and then disappeared into a hollow. Tenyak and Changun raced towards the hollow. As they had guessed, it was a cave. The sunlight lit up the interior at the cave's mouth. The walls of the tunnel-like cave were coated with white crystals. Heaps of crystals rose like molehills from the floor and dangled like wasps' nests from the ceiling. The pure white crystalline heaps glittered in the slanting rays of the afternoon sun. Tenyak bent down and picked up a pinch of the crystals, putting it to the tip of his tongue.
"It's salt,"
he whispered in wonder, as if unable to believe his tongue. Soon he began to hop about wildly, in imitation of a tribal war dance, whooping and shrieking in gay abandon.
"We found salt,"
he cried. Changun crooned,
"There's enough salt in this cave to last our village 1,000 years. That tunnel-like cave is a natural salt mine. The spring flowed through it, carrying some of the salt away,"
said Changun. The sun was already halfway down on its journey across the horizon. The children knew they must hurry back to their village. Though they wanted to locate the salt spring, they knew this was not the right time. They drank the water in the bamboo tubes. Then they placed the tubes upside down on the ground to dry them completely. They packed the tubes with salt. Then, carrying the treasure upon their backs, they began the descent home. The villagers had meanwhile begun worrying. When they saw the 2 children descend, the crowd broke out into loud cheers. The children ran excitedly to Grandma Kamlong. They shouted,
"We've found a cave of salt! Our village will be prosperous again!"
Unstrapping the bamboo tubes, they poured the salt onto the earth. The heaps glowed in the light of the setting sun. Grandma laughed happily.
"Well done, children,"
the chief said.
"Your courage deserves to be rewarded. You too will be the chief guests during this Loku festival."
Picking Tenyak up, the chief placed him on his shoulders. Changun's father picked her up and placed her on his shoulders. Grandma Kamlong broke out into a Nokt ballad for courage. The villagers sang along and began a grand celebration.